The design of keyboards has barely changed in over 150 years. Typewriters from the 1870s shared the same layout as most modern keyboards. While typing technology has advanced, the design of computer keyboards has remained largely unchanged. But why is that? Are computer keyboards so perfect that they don't need any changes? Or is the current design so deeply ingrained that changing it would be like reinventing the wheel? I believe both of these assumptions are mostly false. First of all, standard keyboards have some inherent problems. One of them is the offset key columns. Ideally, horizontal finger movement should be minimized, allowing your fingers to move primarily up and down on the vertical axis. The reason for this offset traces back to the early typewriters using the QWERTY layout. This layout was created in the 1870s and was used on the first commercially successful typewriter, the Remington No. 1. At that time, the offset was necessary to fit all the levers while keeping the keys close together. But today, it is completely unnecessary. Some companies have started to produce keyboards without the horizontal offset, known as ortholinear keyboards. Although I haven't found any studies suggesting that these keyboards improve efficiency, many people online report an increase in both comfort and typing speed after switching to an ortholinear keyboard. Now, let's talk about the layout itself. As I mentioned, QWERTY was invented over 150 years ago, and it remains the most popular keyboard standard worldwide. But is it the most effective? Not really. Ideally, the most frequently used keys should all be located on the home row, the central row of the keyboard. However, heat maps of the most used letters in the English alphabet showed that this is not the case on the QWERTY layout. Two of the most popular alternative layouts that aim to address this issue are Dvorak and Kolmak. Regarding Dvorak, I found a paper that demonstrates its theoretical superiority over QWERTY. The most frequently used letters are placed on the home row, reducing finger movement. And mathematically, Dvorak has a significantly smaller total key distance. However, in practice, the results are a bit less impressive. While Dvorak does improve typing speeds compared to QWERTY, the difference is only about 4-5%, likely due to the steep learning curve. But there is still hope with the relatively new layout, Kolmak, released in 2006 by Shai Coleman. Like Dvorak, it aims to minimize finger movement by placing frequently used letters on the home row, but it retains keyboard shortcuts and non-alphabetic character placement from QWERTY, making it supposedly easier to learn. According to the Kolmak.com website, Kolmak requires 2.2 times less finger movement than QWERTY, 16 times less same hand row jumping, and 35 times more words can be typed using only the home row. If these numbers are correct, then Kolmak is clearly the superior keyboard layout. Another issue with keyboards and their layouts is the existence of multiple standards. With over 7,000 languages, many with unique alphabets and characters, keyboards can look differently around the world. Sometimes these differences are minor. For example, in German-speaking countries, the standard layout is QWERTY instead of QWERTY, meaning the Z and Y keys are swapped. I use a QWERTY keyboard my whole life, so when I came to study here in Germany, it was reels and ozing to use the keyboard. But this is a minor change compared to how Asian keyboards look and function. For example, the Chinese language has over 50,000 characters. That's quite a bit more than the 26 letters of the English alphabet. And yet, the Chinese typists still use the QWERTY layout. They found a clever way to adapt to the Western technology. Typing on a Chinese keyboard activates an algorithm based either on the character's phonetic sound or root shape. The algorithm then suggests different words based on the user's input, allowing the user to select the desired one. This is a smart workaround, but it also highlights the lack of flexibility in traditional hardware keyboards. While researching the functionality of Chinese keyboards, I started wondering, how did Chinese typewriters look like? And I stumbled on some fascinating and also a bit terrifying images. The issue of multiple standards and languages isn't as problematic on mobile because virtual keyboards allow users to easily switch between different layouts for different languages, with no need for keyboard shortcuts or key combinations. But it wasn't always like this. The first phone I ever had was a Nokia 6300, and typing on that thing took ages. That's because it only had 12 keys, and you had to press the same key multiple times to get to the desired letter. Then came BlackBerries, stylus phones, and eventually the iPhone with its fully virtual mobile keyboard. But why am I talking about this? Because it shows that innovation in the keyboard industry is possible and maybe even necessary. Over the years, there have been several attempts to revolutionize the keyboard market, like the aforementioned ortholinear keyboards or split keyboards, which aim to minimize ulnar deviation, a condition where the wrist bends towards the little finger, potentially leading to carpal tunnel syndrome. Despite these efforts, none of these inventions have actually managed to replace the mainstream keyboard layout that most of us still use. However, there might be some interesting inventions on the horizon. About a year ago, a video showcasing a fully transparent keyboard with a built-in display went viral, gaining over 1.7 million views. The Flux keyboard appears to combine the tactile feel of traditional keyboards with the flexibility of virtual ones. But since this thing is still in development and there aren't any actual reviews out yet, it's hard to tell whether this thing is actually any good or just another dead Kickstarter project. In the end, maybe the traditional keyboard design is outdated, but it still works well enough. Then again, most of my keyboard-related frustrations could probably be summed up in two words: skill issue. By the way, the YouTube algorithm thinks you will really enjoy this next video of mine that you see on the screen right now. Thanks for watching. Bye.